Hello, fellow truth seekers. If you're like me, you want to know the truth. You're looking for the truth. Well, guess what, Jim and I? We're going to give it to you today on WebDM. They call them protectors, guardians of the forest, Bigfoot, Sasquatch. They're out there.
Bigfoot? What are you talking about?
Yes, because today we're talking about Firbolgs on WebDM. Alrighty, Jim. Not really sure where to start with this one, but we're gonna start. Firbolgs.
Firbolgs.
Where the hell did Firbolgs come from? You lift up a rock and there's a baby Firbolg. And
in terms of like the history of D&D races and stuff, Firbolgs have been around for a while. First edition is when they make their appearance. They're sort of like akin to ogres, but more human looking. They had like great big beards, like red fiery beards and manes of hair and everything.
Yeah, the only one I can think of is the one from the Cleric Quintet.
Yes. Yeah.
He was with an assassin guy. He was not happy.
He was not happy. No.
But he was always just kind of like a big, like Viking red-haired giant kind of thing, right?
Yeah. That's how I always saw them as. And like I can remember like the second edition, I forget the name of it, but it was like it was the book sort of like playing monstrous humanoids, and Firbolg was one of those that was always off limits because our DM was like, yeah, you can't be like a human-looking giant that has the ability to shrink down to human size, therefore letting you like go into the taverns and shops and everything like that. They just like felt that it was too good of an option for something. And so in my mind, they were never like an option as like a playable character race. Like I never felt like that they needed to be included in anything or anything like that. And so I just kind of put them out of my mind. They're one of many giant kin that that fall outside the classic, you know, hill through storm kind of giant structure, and more like ogres and Etten and cyclops and things like that. They do come from Irish folklore. They have strong Celtic themes, and like at least in the early editions of the game, they were skilled illusionists and were reclusive and tended to live in forests and the like. They were very different, at least visually, than the Firbolg that we have now in 5th edition.
I know what the book says, that they're like these guardians of nature, and they don't want to be messed with, and you just want to just pass on through a Firbolg's territory if possible. How do you see them, like, beyond the text? Like, how do you see them in the world?
Yeah, I think I see them as like somewhere akin to forest gnomes or wood elves. They fit in with that reclusive humanoid that tends to live in forests and the like. And like forests play a big deal in like Dungeons and Dragons lore. You've got druids who tend to be, you know, based around like forests and trees and groves and things like that. Even though Circle of the Land has other environments, but forest gnomes, wood elves, there's something about the woods. Yeah. The forest that's central to Dungeons and Dragons. Like, we don't have necessarily like a playable race that's like, yeah, they're strongly tied to, say, swamps in the same way that Firbolgs and wood elves and forest gnomes are tied to their environment, right? Like, you can find, you know, lizard folk in the swamp, but not like they don't have special powers that, that manifest that sort of like make that connection, right? As a race, I find it like difficult to place and overlapping with some other options that are already out there. And so that suggests to me like either they can maybe form like an integrated society with those other humanoids, whether elves or gnomes, or maybe there's like a blurring of the lines between the three in the same way that I blur the lines between goblin, hobgoblin, and bugbear. That maybe these are just like forest spirits that come from the Feywild. And when they first arrive in the world, they're maybe the size of like gnomes or something, you know? And then as they spend more and more time in their forests, they grow up and become larger and larger until they have this like strong connection where they're from, where they become Firbolgs, and they go from forest gnome to wood elf to Firbolg. And that's kind of the evolution of them as a fantasy and mystical creature.
Maybe it's kind of like, it could be a thing where like parrots, like the size of the forest determines the size of the Firbolg. Like forest, you can have a bigger Firbolg.
Yes.
Because he adapts to his or her environment.
Absolutely.
Like that way.
What strikes me as the most interesting about the Firbolg as presented in 5th edition, now I liked the sort of like Gaelic warrior type that, like the image of that from prior editions, but I feel like, you know, that's a Goliath, or something like that. You know, I mean, there's ways to represent that.
Yeah, there's a lot of big guys with powerful build, and they're strong warriors.
You have a lot of options for big, strong warrior types, including the Firbolg, right? Like, you could easily make a fighter or a barbarian or something out of it, and it would be just fine. But now we have one, a giant type that's a bit more mystical, that's a bit more spiritual even. And I really like giant spellcasters. Like, I like the idea of casters that are either really small, like tiny, or like really big. And mostly because, you know, typically whenever you have a caster as an antagonist, they might be like a human or an elf or something like that. I think like changing their size is one way to make them seem different or unique. And Firbolg is a nice presentation of it and a nice way to like either reskin it or use it as a base, just because it's, to me, it's different. It's very much unique in 5th edition, I think. Mm-hmm. Maybe closest it comes to is gnomes in terms of like reclusiveness and needing to find an excuse for them to be adventuring.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like a dwarf where they're just like, yeah, they're kind of expected that you'll find a bunch of dwarves out adventuring, you know, or, you know, humans or halflings or something, where it's like, yeah, it's pretty normal to see them out and about in the world and doing things. But Firbolg, that's different. They usually like to be by themselves, and so there must be a reason for them being out here.
According to Volos, they're usually pretty tragic. I mean, it's your standard, you know, I did something horrible and was outcast, or my tribe was destroyed by this or that, or natural disaster.
Yeah.
Of course, those are just suggestions. There's many reasons to go adventuring, you know, finding, you know, what if the first tree has been stolen from the forest and you have to go take it back?
So there's all kinds of things like that. If it's something that was taken from them, or something that's like, you know, they need something from the world. There's a resource that they're running out of. Maybe they've been reclusive for so long that people have forgotten about them, or they just don't know, or maybe only the elves remember them or something, but some sort of disaster strikes, and all of a sudden this new people emerges or reemerges from their, you know, isolation, and it's like, yeah, well, you know, we were living in this part of the world until, like, the dragon wing came down and, like, burned the entire forest to the ground or made it uninhabitable. Currently, it's got to, like, be healed or cleansed or something like that. Mm-hmm. And so these formerly reclusive type people who would otherwise prefer to be left alone, prefer to be, you know, just don't bother us, we'll be fine. We're not interested in being power players and taking center stage in all the events that shake up these worlds. Now they have to find a place for themselves, and you could like represent that through your character, through events in the game, through all kinds of different things that bring out what's unique about these creatures, and also like fully integrate them into your world.
Oh yeah, definitely be like a scout sent one direction when ten others were sent other directions. Yeah. And just looking for a place. Looking for that new Eden.
What if this? What if instead of them being like fey creatures, that Firbolgs are sort of like proto-humans? They maybe are like, along with say Goliaths and I don't know, let's call it, you know, another kind of like giantish race, like half ogres. Maybe they represent proto-humanity, and that humanity is just a like a diminutive giant, you know, like every generation of giants just gets a little smaller and a little smaller until eventually, and more numerous until eventually you have like humans, and maybe Firbolgs are like the next step in that magic, or the prior step in that magical evolution, you know, like
the Neanderthal or
primitive is a loaded word, but maybe they do choose to live a more naturalistic lifestyle, and they shun the trappings of civilization because those come from gods, and listen, the gods were not here when this place was made. Like, they are, you know, late arrivals on the scene, you know, in terms of epochs of your fantasy worlds. And so the Firbolgs are like, yeah, no thanks. Well, you know, we don't really worship gods. We don't buy into their whole, like, you know, civilization is great kind of propaganda. Mm-hmm. You know, we developed druidic magic on our own using just, like, the natural magic of the world that, it, you know, and we don't need it. We get along just fine. You know, it's you. It's y'all. It's, you know, the Firbolgs that left the forest and became humans. You guys have lost your way.
Yeah.
And so maybe your Firbolg is someone there who's like trying to convince others to like come back. You know, this is you're on the wrong course. You know, mm-hmm. these cities, this trade business that you got going on, this extracting minerals and the whatnot from the earth. Like, that's not, leave that to the dwarves. Come on back. We want you back. And like, that's their sort of angle is one of reaching out to, a lost splinter group of theirs. And, you know, they would prefer to be just left alone, but they've got to save humanity. They just mm-hmm. gotta.
It's the burden of every savior to save what it is supposed to.
Yeah,
right?
A lot of that in D&D, yeah. Yeah.
A lot of orphans adventuring and a lot of saviors of the world, yeah. Born every day.
D&D is an inherently magical world, right? Yeah. And the natural world of D&D is, by the rules and just sort of like by implication, it's a world suffused with magic. And so, and like their role is sort of like the shepherds of the forest. Maybe they, you know, because they can live for so long, maybe they are like tree tenders, you know, that they, it's their job to, you know, nurture, sapling treants into full sentience, mm-hmm. or something like that. Or they're the ones responsible for, you know, the annual Congress of Animals, which gets together every spring to determine how many deer can the wolves kill this year, how many, you know, mm-hmm. they all got to hash it out, because guess all of these animals, they can talk, they have, you know, I like a fantasy world in which the animals are like not quite Narnia levels of intelligent, but are more than just natural animals.
Yeah, you were a Disney kid.
I was a Disney kid, right? Like, yeah. I like a world in which, you know, the speak with beasts opens up more than just like a conversation with a dumb sparrow. You know, it opens up possibilities to like debate what it means to be predator and prey in the natural world, or a chance to ask the sacrifice you're about to make to the gods, you know, listen, we're about to sacrifice you for our, you know, veneration. Is that all right? Like, are you cool with that? And you maybe have to convince the animals that, yeah, it's all right, we're cool. You know, that's part and parcel of the deal. And maybe like Firbolgs are the ones that fit into this. They are the intercessors and mediators between the natural world and the civilized world, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Sorry.
You're right.
Yeah, no, when you were talking about an animal acquiescing to its own sacrifice, I can't not think of the South Park where they're bringing about Satan and they sacrifice. Yes, feast upon my flesh. Yes. Sorry.
No, yeah, yeah.
Sorry,
yeah,
that's, yeah, an aside the critter, there.
Yeah.
Yeah, critter Christmas.
So it could be one of those things where it's like, you know, the cows of the world, the domesticated animals of the world, they've removed them, they voluntarily removed themselves from the natural order and placed themselves under humanity's care because they were like, yeah, we're tired of being eaten by wolves. You know, like, we would rather the, we know this is going to happen, the people treat us well, you know, we help them, but, you know, like, the terror of running through a forest and being chased by a predator replaced with, you know, the just slow, inexorable doom of being cattle.
Would that make the dog, like the wolves that allowed themselves to be domesticated by humans, like the Lebowskis of the world?
Or wolves are the dogs that rebelled against humanity.
Oh, you know, the other way? Like, dogs were a thing and then some of them went feral?
And some of them went feral. Some were like, this is a raw deal. I like worlds where druidic magic is sort of like the foundational magic, the one that was sort of maybe studied first, or the one that was discovered as opposed to like gifted by the gods or something.
Yeah.
And I also sort of enjoy that idea that the natural world of a Dungeons & Dragons setting is magical in and of itself and opens up this whole other vista of play that you can just have fun with. And you can create conflicts involving, say, natural creatures and natural phenomenon that don't necessarily have to be like these world-shaking events. But it could be like, yeah, the local predator-prey balance is out of whack. We can't just hunt them all to extinction. Like, you've got to, like, talk to these creatures. You've got to, like, find out what's going on. Maybe there's a demon that's messing about with the natural world. Like, mm-hmm. like, why would demons only target, you know, people? Why wouldn't they target natural animals and turn them into monsters and things like that?
Yeah.
The Firbolg's job is to put a stop to that, you know?
Yeah,
it's that crack team of forest gnomes, wood elves, and Firbolgs. Gotta save the forest.
We were talking about this the other day, and I think you mentioned another possible lineage of the, or genealogy of the Firbolg.
Yeah.
Because they do share traits with giants and elves, that much like half elves and humans, like, what if elves and Goliaths or whatever kind of were like, hey.
Elves seem to have a malleable genome, I guess, that can easily be combined with others. And, you know, maybe there's undoubtedly magic involved in these unions. And so it could just be this the same thing. They make half elves for a variety of different reasons. They're, whether it's, you know, sort of strategic interests or love or accident or whatever, then why not Firbolgs? Why not, you know, something else? Or maybe it's like they're gnomes and elves, and just like the weird fey energy of it causes them to get much bigger or something. I don't know. You know, like, it's fantasy. Like, just come up with an explanation that works for your group. As is, the 5th edition Firbolg has ties to its roots in both mythology and earlier editions of the game. It's got ties to, say, the 4th edition Firbolgs, which were mostly from the Feywild. But it's a race that's like not a traditional adventuring one, not a traditional one that you might see. And if you don't pay much attention to, say, Critical Role, and you're not like checking out all the cool Firbolgs they have over there, then you might be like, who plays one of these? Mm-hmm. And so it's your opportunity to create something like new and different and open up other areas of your campaign. Yeah. for the fantastical.
Well, I mean, they do seem like they were made for the kind of loner outcast types. Like those people that just like, that's the character they make. Well,
yeah.
Here's a race with that just baked in.
And it doesn't have like the inherent sort of violence of, say, like a half-orc who tends to be sort of like loners and the like, where it's all rage and the, you know, implications of how they came about. And you know, you just have to overcome all of this sort of baggage for half-orcs. And you just, at the end of the day, you might not want to play a half-orc, but you could, say, do something like a Firbolg, and it's like, they have this dichotomy of tenderness, of gentleness, of wanting to be quiet and solitary and calm, and yet stat-wise they're really a great, you know, they get a lot of great traits, and they are, you know, roused to anger, are as terrible as nature when it is unleashed its fury. Mm-hmm. So that's, in that respect, that's great. And, you know, we always need more races that do make for good druids.
They make amazing druids. Yeah. I think they could also make a pretty decent, like, a strength-based monk.
Sure.
Like, yeah. I mean, they live with these animals, and it's much like, you know, like a studying the crane or mm-hmm. the tiger as it moves through the forest, but, you know, just in a more naturalistic way.
Yeah.
Like, you're there and you live with them, and so you just emulate them, mm-hmm. not for any kind of, like, oh, I'm creating this martial art.
Yeah.
For perfecting nature's promise.
Yes.
But you are just part of them.
And why wouldn't they have monks, right? Like, they don't, if one of the things that's always gotten me about these forest creatures, right, and these forest peoples in D&D is, like, how do they live? Like, how does a wood elf live? Where do they get metal from? Do they even use it? Like, what are they eating? And so you can kind of see, like, yeah, if they're not mining, if they're not, you know, practicing sort of like those industrial arts and crafts, things like that, then why wouldn't they come up with a natural martial art mm-hmm. to make up for the fact that they don't use a lot of, like, weapons and things like that, but they still need to defend themselves. They've mm-hmm. got a stout quarterstaff, they've got a sling, they've got, you know, the simple weapons that you can make from the forest, but what they have are big, meaty hands mm-hmm. and a long reach and patience.
Have any other, like, actual, like, kind of play concepts before we move into the traits?
I think the last one that I would touch on is they're sometimes depicted as, like, semi-bovine, right?
And yeah, so yeah, like in the face yeah. area, yeah.
And I think, like, that's a fun way to kind of connect them to minotaurs.
A Goliath, a minotaur, and a wood elf all got together one night and got drunk. A little magic happened.
And we kind of like that. Maybe they are the shaman and more, you know, connected from the natural world that, say, the minotaurs came from. Now, there are a lot of, say, problems with the way, like, I don't know, Warcraft depicts Tauren, so I wouldn't necessarily go in that direction, but you could have it be more like, you know, if minotaurs are not like the demonic bull people that they are in baseline D&D, then they could just be like another kind of natural creature that comes about. And perhaps Firbolgs are just like a type of minotaur that is, you know, particularly skilled with magic and mm-hmm. remaining unseen.
Kind of moving into their traits.
Yes.
Obviously, because of their ability bumps, I mean, they're prime for clerics, druids, anything like that. The +2 wisdom, +1 strength.
For druids, like, this is where I really start feeling like, man, druids need a melee subclass. Like, non-moon druids take advantage of Shillelagh and Flameblade and Barkskin and, like, all of the kind of, like, get-up-in-your-face druid spells mm-hmm. that, say, like, a 2nd or 3rd edition druid could get away with. You know, there was an image of the druid, like, wooden shield, flaming scimitar, rough bark-like skin, standing next to the barbarian, the cleric, the fighter in the front lines.
Yeah.
And, like, I think there's still room for that in 5th edition, and Firbolgs would definitely be able to take advantage of that with their stats.
Like Nature's Avenger or something like that.
Yeah.
Like someone that's a little bit more like hard edge. Maybe got to take back nature from all this progression.
Yeah.
Encroachment.
Or it's sort of like the fourth edition Warden, which combined a little bit of like limited shape shifting from the Druid, but was also sort of a fighter, paladin-esque kind of character.
Yeah.
So in that sense, you could see, like, particularly if you're open to letting classes switch what their casting stat is, you do like Oath of Ancients Paladin instead of Charisma, switch to Wisdom because it's more in keeping with like the just the theme of that kind of paladin, you know, an ancient guardian of nature that just like, you know, watches over the treant nursery groves and you know, keeps the sacred places of the world safe from wicked things and mankind
and from themselves, because as we all learn, once they get a little sap in them, they can be those treants, they can mouth off. They have a pretty decent array. I mean, the fact that they can detect magic and disguise self once per short long rest, and getting that like the vestige from the older editions, like you could do 3 feet shorter.
Sure, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So you could really fit in. Because, I mean, they, you know, these guys are topping like 8 feet sometimes.
I would say, like, the disguise self is a shorthand for what they can do. And it's not necessarily like it works exactly like the spell does. It would just be like, if we need to clarify something, it'll work kind of like the spell, but maybe it's somewhere between disguise and alter self. You know, the illusion is so powerful that it's not just appearance, but it actually, you know, does something like actually change their shape in a limited capacity.
Mm-hmm.
I would play it like that just because this seems almost like a ribbon ability. You know, I mean, not like the disguise self, because that's pretty useful, but like the ability to like go up to 3 feet in either direction, which means you could do it in the opposite direction too, right?
I think in the book it says you can do it up to 3 feet shorter. I don't think it actually says, but I could be wrong.
I would change that. Because then you could just be like...
You think they should hit 11 feet?
Well, I think they could appear to be 11 feet tall, right? Like, that's the thing, is they could appear to be 11 feet tall, and maybe that sort of, like, plays into their keeping people away. Like, maybe they choose this time, like, all right, I'm going to shrink myself down and try to avoid notice, but maybe this time I want to scare these people off, so I appear as, like, an 11, 12-foot tall vine and leaf-covered, you know, cow person of the forest. Then it might scare away some dirt farmer peasants who I don't want, you know, coming up in here to find charcoal for their fires or anything like that. Or even like swapping, say, detect magic out for minor illusion and like really going hard on their, you know, connections with illusion magic and the like.
Because also they get that hidden step bonus action, they be invisible till the start of the next turn.
Yeah.
Once per short long rest.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just a quick little like get out of jail free card kind of thing.
I mean, this is one of those where, you know, you might use it if, say, you know, you're the only you're the only visible target and there's an enemy spellcaster around. You're like, no, I'm gonna just like not right now, I don't want to have to worry about that. Or you need to, say, get away from a you know, a cluster of enemies or something like that. You don't want to just disengage and hope they don't follow. Bonus action, then dash out of there.
I can see it as along with their whole like guardian thing is you know, if there's some people in your grove, you know, get their attention, lead them away, and that's when you hit your invisibility to double back.
Right.
So you
can
just kind of get them out of the way, and you don't have to attack, don't have to fight them.
Uh-huh.
It's a nice passive way to just, you know, deter people from your area.
Yeah, make your escape, or even set up an ambush if they are, you know, going on the offensive.
You got all your animals of the forest because use that speech of the beast to talk to them.
Yes.
And be like, hey, tigers, I need you over here. You know, wolves, I need you down that pit. You know, I'm going to lead them through. You don't have to eat them, but I know you'll have it eaten in a while.
I know that we mentioned it in the Triton episode where we were, you know, talking about how this ability to speak with animals in a limited capacity where it's like you can tell the animal something, but you can't necessarily understand anything back. That's one of those where I favor a more expansive version. Maybe not to the point where you're like, you know, functionally have like that warlock invocation, but something at the very least where a more limited form of communication is enabled and not like you know, you just boss around some animals and they can't tell you anything back.
No, it needs to definitely be like old Yeller communication, you know, yeah. Like, you know, it comes up barking, what's that? Yeah. Timmy, he's in the well, you know, and the animal leads you over.
Maybe there's a check involved in order for you to sort of like interpret, you know, what's
an
going on.
Check.
An insight check, or even just like an animal handling with intelligence instead of wisdom, mm-hmm. you know, something like that, that lets you sort of like intuit or interpret what it is that these creatures are telling you. You know, you can do that with your house animals without, you don't need magic to do that.
Oh, I definitely know when Monk wants me to feed him.
Right, yeah.
Especially when it's just empty in the middle.
No, they're never going to eat the side food. I mean, that's kind of like how I would interpret that, just because I like I said, I like the idea of a world filled with like talking intelligent animals that are one spell or ability away from you being able to communicate with them. In a D&D world, the fact that it's all magical, it's all fantastic, and there's not really anything about it that's natural or mundane, even if it appears so, it has a strong appeal to me, because I like a world where magic is around every corner. It might be subtle, it might be, you know, slow acting, and it might be like, you know, not flashy, but it's present, and it doesn't rely on just saying like, oh, well, this is just like the real world, don't worry about it, there's nothing special here. It appears that way, but it isn't actually. And that's the promise of the Firbolg for me, is like the appearance of the mundane, the appearance of the gentle and the kind and the kind of non-adventurous that hides a soul that's fierce and willing to do what it can to protect itself and is willing to go outside of its comfort zone in order to do what's right for its community, for the place that it cares for. And in that sense, Firbolgs are like really unique and different mm-hmm. in Dungeons & Dragons.
Sometimes Firbolg has to take a stand.
If you like the video, give it a thumbs up and subscribe. If you need more WebDM talk, we've got a podcast and a whole lot more on our Patreon. We just talked to Wolfgang Bauer, the head of Kobold Press, about D&D, his career, and more. It's available free, so download it now. Oh, and he gave our patrons a huge discount on some great stuff, too. Link here and in the description.
Jim, pancakes or waffles?
I mean, I prefer pancakes, but waffles are, like, the height of waffles is going to be better than pancakes, but for consistency, pancakes.
Yeah, pancakes all the way. Unless you're talking about making a peanut butter and jelly waffle sandwich, which I do highly recommend. I recommend just using Eggos. It's the perfect size for it. You can also substitute Nutella for either of those two ingredients.
But, yeah, Nutella's a great pancake and waffle.
Biscuits.
It's the same situation. If the cornbread's good, it's going to blow the biscuits out of the water, but more likely that the cornbread's going to be bad.
Yeah, the cornbread's probably going to be dry, unless it was my grandmother's. I think everybody's grandmother made the best cornbread. It's the kind of stuff that, like, she would do this thing, like, right when she got out of the oven, she would smear it with butter right then. Then it would just kind of melt into it and serve it like that.
Yeah.
And of course, then everybody else would put more butter on it.
Put more butter on, yeah.
But the fact that you could just grab a slice straight out and it's like buttered and fresh, oh, it's like the best cornbread ever.
Yeah.
But I'm the same way. I love a good biscuit. I mean,
yeah.
You can do a biscuit, you know, I don't know.
Consistently a biscuit, but, you know, if the cornbread's good, it's going to be better than any biscuit.
Yeah.
Come on. Especially if it's got like.
I can't make a breakfast sandwich out of cornbread.
You can't.
But you can out of a biscuit. A biscuit has more utility.
Certainly more utility a biscuit does.
Same way with the waffle.
Is it, we're talking about a flaky biscuit, a buttermilk biscuit? What are we talking about here?
Buttermilk biscuits.
We're talking about buttermilk biscuits, but my next question for you before I go is sweet cornbread or normal cornbread?
Sweet cornbread.
Thank you.
Duh.
That's the correct
What's
answer.
Normal cornbread?
There is a cornbread. Well, go to Cracker Barrel.
Yeah, Cracker Barrel.
Cracker Barrel serves the unsweet cornbread.
The kind that you have to like literally slather butter on both sides.
You gotta butter the shit.
Because you take a bite and all the moisture sucks out of your mouth.
Well, they like to put peppers in them.
Well, I don't necessarily
mind
like the spicy cornbread, like when they put like peppers or like tiny bits of corn. Now, I hate it when they put
like
big whole chunks of corn.
Yeah.
Like where I'm biting through and it's literally like a chocolate chip cookie, but instead it's corn. Like it's cornbread. I'm already there with the cornmeal. I don't need the full chunks of corn.
I just like a little bit of whole corn kernels and bacon bits. Crumbled up bacon. Real bacon, too. Not that bullshit.
Yeah, not the fake bacon bits.
No, not faking.